Welcome to the Plant Trainers Podcast, where we're helping people improve their quality of life through nutrition and fitness. And now, your hosts, nutrition and wellness coaches, international speakers, Adam and Shoshana Chaim.
Hey, I'm Adam Chaim.
And I'm Shoshana Chaim, and we are
Propelled by Plants. Today we bring to you episode 415, Bringing Animal Protection into Schools with Mike Farley.
In this episode of the Plant Trainers Podcast, we talk to Mike Farley all about bringing animal protection into schools. If you've never thought of this before, you're really going to be blown away today. We talk about history books, we talk about class trips, dissections, and so much more. Animals are really being exploited right before our children's eyes. You're going to hear what you can do about it, how you can make a difference, and about the Educators for Animals conference that Mike has created that takes place this August.
Mike Farley has been teaching middle and high school geography for 20 years in Toronto. Over the past decade, he's explored animal protection with his students, including running virtual field trips to animal sanctuaries during the pandemic. Mike is a frequent presenter at conferences in Canada and the US on topics such as human rights, environmental issues, and animal protection. He's currently finishing his graduate degree in Humane Education and working on curriculum projects for the Factory Farming Awareness Coalition. Mike's also starting an organization called Educators for Animals Canada that is bringing together educators from across the country who are incorporating animal protection into their school communities. In 2014, the Royal Canadian Geographical Society presented Mike with the Innovation in Geography Teaching Award, the highest honor for geography teaching in Canada. The conference we're going to share with you in this episode that comes out in August is going to be spectacular. Pay attention because you're not going to want to miss this. Share this out with any teacher you know, whether they're in Canada or the US or anywhere else in the world. Enjoy the show.
Great news, everybody. I Am a Peaceful Goldfish. My picture book is available everywhere books are sold, in stores and online. It's perfect for any children ages 0 to 7. So stock up on your birthday presents and baby shower gifts today. We do have a limited amount of signed copies. If you would like one, please email us at info@planttrainers.com.
And now for a moment of gratitude.
We celebrated our son's bar mitzvah, and it was a beautiful day. It's when a boy turns 13 and has a coming of age, and it was just so beautiful. All the hard work he did and the hard work his sister did, it was just such a beautiful day, and it was nice to be able to spend it with a couple of family members.
Yeah, I'm grateful for all of the family that was able to join us and for everyone who joined us online and for just an amazing experience as a family, and super proud of that kid.
Mike Farley, thank you so much for joining us on the Plant Trainers Podcast today.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to be here.
We're excited too. And we did a clubhouse with you last week, and we have some other exciting things coming up. But before we get into all things good, we wanted to know if you had a moment of gratitude to share with us and our listeners.
Yeah, I'm very grateful for, especially the last couple of months, we'll get into this a bit more in the podcast, but just meeting so many amazing educators across Canada who are working in the areas of promoting plant-based lifestyle and animal protection. And it's just been so eye-opening and inspiring to be part of that process.
Well, we do want to speak a little bit more about that process, and I can't imagine how many amazing people you've met along the way, and you could tell us a little bit about some of them soon. But before we get into that, we always love to know how you found your vegan or plant-based lifestyle and what changed for you along the way.
Yeah, so when I was in university in the 90s, I started learning about more environmental issues, became vegetarian at that point, but pretty much solely due to carbon emissions, climate change, etc. And it wasn't only until about 4 years ago, we actually adopted a little doggy, and something for my wife and I just switched. There was a switch that happened where we realized that she had been kept in a cage for about 4 years before we got her. And we started realizing that extended to so many other animals out there as well. And so something was kind of waiting to be flicked on, and that was the impetus that did it. And then since then, it's kind of been an ever unfolding exploration of other things that we can do to go more plant-based and to help animals out.
It's amazing how you start off in one direction, and this, like, you started off in climate and then it moved to animals. I started off in health and it moved into animals and like environment. And it's just a domino effect. And there's so much impact that every single one of us can make in so many different ways. So it's pretty cool to hear different people's perspectives and stories and growth process.
I couldn't agree more. I mean, now for me, the health aspect is becoming more, you know, apparent to me. And then also looking at, you know, human rights aspects as well. So it's seemingly just never ending. For me, it just feels like it's going to be a lifelong process, but an amazing one, a critical one. Yeah.
And for those people who think that they have it and they know exactly where they are, there is always progress that happens. We are always learning more, discover more, meet a new person that flicks another light switch in our heads or another documentary. So there is always room for process and room for saying, you know what, I'm going to take the next couple of years and concentrate more on climate or concentrate more on animals or concentrate more on health, right?
Yeah. Yeah. It's so great you're saying that, Shoshana, because it creates a deep sense of humility around all of this as well. Because Dr. Melanie Joy speaks about vegan amnesia, you know, where you can't remember when you weren't this way. And yet it was only a few years ago that I kind of actually woke up to this. So approaching this humility and realizing that you're going to keep having these aha movements as you move throughout your life. Ideally, that would be the best thing, that you're always learning, right? So
Dr. Melanie Joy talked to us on the show about, and she always talks about this, you know, it's, why is it okay to eat pigs and cows, but not okay to eat dogs and cats? And it's such a mind flip that people don't really pay attention to. And one of the things that you're working on through your education process is bringing more awareness to animal rights and the welfare of animals and putting that into school systems. And we want to get into that a little bit today.
Yeah. Tell us a little bit more about the initiative of Educators for Animals Conference.
Yeah. So it started actually a few months ago. I've been increasingly incorporating animal protection issues into my classes probably for the last 10 years or so. It started with kind of more wildlife issues. And then, of course, over the last few years with my own switches, it's gone more to animals that we're eating or that we're experimenting on or using for entertainment, et cetera, et cetera. So I've been trying different things, but I started to reach out to a few other educators that I knew that were working in these areas as well. And, you know, realized that, wow, there was just that kept growing and growing. So word kind of spread. I started reaching out more and more and realized that, you know, there was people all across Canada who were working in a variety of school systems, anywhere from pre-K all the way to post-secondary, who were doing their own thing in this area. But the common refrain was that they felt quite isolated in doing that. They felt isolated in their own school. They kind of had to do this behind closed doors. They didn't really have too many allies wherever they were working. And so I found this incredible strength in actually being able to start bringing people together. And then in speaking to people, that idea of a conference really emerged. So now it's up to about 125 educators. How can we bring as many of those folks together? And that's really the conference in August. That's where that came from.
Well, I'm super excited for the conference, and I thank you so much for including me in that. I'm excited for my role in that. But I really wanted to know a little bit more about the difference between or the difference your administration, or as you're talking to these people, their administrations might feel, is if you're talking about animal protection in wildlife and in climate and all of that, but then you go and you switch to animal protection in terms of the food that we eat, is it viewed in a different way? And is that almost taboo? And is that what they feel like they have to say behind closed doors? But they're okay to say, let's protect the squirrels and the lions and the fox and all of that. Are they finding there's a difference between the reaction there?
I think so. I mean, I had a few stories of some of these educators actually being pulled into the principal's office, you know, because there had been some concern about what they're talking, and they weren't doing it in a heavy-handed way at all from what I understood. But there was a fear about how this was going to proceed. And it was interesting. There was a sense of, like, you can't impose your values on the students. But I mean, as educators, we're doing that all the time. And at least we're opening up a conversation, whether it's about climate change or social justice or compassion or kindness. These are values that we're talking about all the time. So it's just interesting that that kind of stops as soon as you get to things like farmed animals. But I think it was interesting speaking to people, depending on what context they were working in, they were finding different ways of doing it. So for example, some teachers were interested in the animal sentience piece, animal protection piece, but they were going at it from a climate change angle. You know, so talking about we should be eating less animals, or we should be talking about that to reduce our emissions. Some people were definitely coming at it from a health perspective. So there was all these different angles that you could approach it, and people were just having to be creative about it. But that did seem to be there is this sense of a fear of backlash for talking about our relationship with animals overall.
Do you think that's rooted in from industry and government? And that's because we've been taught that way for so many years, that the older population or the principals, the people in leadership, are afraid to make that change and be open to that?
I think that's probably a big part of it. I know, I mean, myself personally growing up, I don't know what your experience was, but I remember being in school and having like milk posters all over my classroom, you know, and I remember the food guide being everywhere. And I know you guys have spoken about how the food guide has changed and a lot of the great changes that have happened with that. But I know, you know, for example, there has been pushback against the food guide. There has been pushback, for example, from the dairy farmers of Ontario in the Ontario curriculum. There has been pushback trying to reemphasize dairy back into the food guide, where it has, you know, starting to be excluded a bit more. So I would say that's a big part of it. And I think it's just something, you know, I don't think there's any villain here. I think we're just all operating within the system that we're all used to and we've been part of for so long, that whenever there's a threat to that status quo system, there's going to be resistance to that. So, I mean, I see it kind of as a natural process, but a necessary one to go through.
So what other areas are animals being exploited in within the educational institutions other than serving milk, like the milk programs and like the basic things that we think of, especially, you know, plant-based listeners, in terms of just feeding animals to kids in lunch programs and stuff like that? Is there animal exploitation within the curriculums?
Yeah, so that was another thing that emerged in speaking to the educators across Canada, was I started to see themes that were coming. So food was a big one, you know, whether, again, you're at pre-K all the way up to post-secondary. I started thinking about my own experience of that, of what snacks I had served, or, you know, during Halloween, what treats I'd given, you know, looking at my own blind spots with regards to that. But so food is definitely a big one. Another big one was just in school. I call them in school or in classroom experiences. Dissection would be the obvious one, that students may feel pressured to do that. And at least in the Ontario curriculum, they actually should have a choice. It's written in the curriculum that they should be given a viable alternative to do that and not pressured to dissect. But it also shows up in these in-school or in-classroom experiences with traveling zoos. I know, Adam, you've spoken a bit about that. Or hatching programs, for example. Also, an interesting one is field trips. That would be another area it shows up. So, for example, places like African Lion Safari or Marineland, they have these kind of very robust field trip programs. It gets a little murkier when you get into things like aquariums and zoos. And I know there's a big spectrum of quality of care there, and there's a lot of debate about that, but at least it's something to look into, especially when there's a lot of amazing alternatives to those. And then finally would just be the curriculum overall. That's a much more difficult one to kind of get our head around, because it's just, you're looking at, again, pre-K all the way to post-secondary, every subject under the sun. But I can say, at least my own experience as a geography teacher, is that animals are not really mentioned that much in the curriculum at all. Wildlife, definitely, biodiversity to some degree. But in terms of our relationship to animals, I would say that it is hardly mentioned at all in our curriculum. So those would be the four main areas.
And what about in history and like the fur trade in Canada, and how I don't think Canada would be what it is today without the fur trade, but how is that message being delivered? And is it being delivered in the sense of
fur trade today is still okay.
Yeah, that's interesting. You know, there's a teacher at my school, Charlotte Spielman, who's going to be, she's a history teacher. She's going to be speaking at the conference about using history to look at our relationship to animals. So she could speak a lot more about that. But for example, she did a lesson with her students on the role of animals in the world wars, you know, and how many animals, I think it was, you know, donkeys and horses were used, for example, in World War One, how many died that we never speak about, that were shipped over, were put to use and were kind of instrumental in these wars and have never really been honored. So when you start digging a little bit deeper, you just see this appearing, you know, in every, pretty much every subject area, you can actually start to see there's a way of actually bringing in these issues, regardless of what you're teaching.
And now you're getting me thinking about dogs in World War II and the Holocaust, and like how many of our ancestors were attacked by dogs. Dogs were trained to kill Jews, right? Yeah. And that's awful as well. And I'm sure a lot of those dogs were killed as well in the process, right? So that's something I never really thought about before from an animal rights point of view.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's where you start to see things maybe shifting a bit. If you start looking historically, there's just a long-term relationship with animals that's one of like domination, exploitation. So this is where we're trying to unpack that through education now. We feel this is a critical space for the educators to have a unique position to be able to at least open up these conversations with students and try and shift that relationship a bit.
I think as teachers, we have the opportunity to really deliver a message in a unique way to our students. And I find that some teachers teach things, the same curriculum, very differently. Like I know for myself, I teach my nutrition unit very differently than some of my coworkers because of my background. And that would go the same for history, I would think, and geography. And teachers are able to...
Taking a little break to let you know that the best gift you can give your child is the tools that they need to get through stressful situations, especially in the world that we're living in today. Stock up on birthday presents and baby shower gifts by ordering a signed copy or a regular copy of my new book, I Am a Peaceful Goldfish, at planttrainers.com, on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Indigo, or anywhere books are sold, in stores and online. It teaches mindfulness and playful breathing techniques for kids and their families to use when they're feeling overwhelmed, using their imagination and inspiration from objects found around the house to help them feel calm and grounded. This book is going to be amazing in your home. And now back to the show.
And teachers are able to navigate to their strengths and their own opinions a little bit while still covering the curriculum as they're supposed to. And I find that a conference like this one is probably going to be very beneficial for a lot of educators that haven't had the experience in teaching these specific topics in this specific way. So is this conference for all teachers or only teachers that are interested in animal exploitation, animal welfare, or anything like that?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, I think I'd really love everybody to come. You know, that would be, even if you have the slightest interest in finding out, well, what? I've never thought about this. You know, I'd be interested in hearing what other educators have to say about this, or I don't fully agree with that. I'd like to come and see what this is all about. Because I think, like Adam, what you're saying, it's so true that our curriculum is somewhat malleable. And I've seen teachers speaking to them, and my own experience has been is that there is some wiggle room within this. There is space to stretch and work within the curriculum that we've been assigned. And so that's an interesting thing to hear from other educators is how they've done that, you know, what best practices around that. Because it is possible, like you're saying with your own teaching, like your teaching is going to look different from another's, but you found a way yourself to actually make that work and to still honor the curriculum and get important messages across and stay out of trouble with the administration. There's definitely ways to do that in any subject area.
Talking about administration, I think you've thought about this already. And if you haven't, I don't want to make you nervous about it. But are you worried about backlash from your administration, from your speaker's administration, from the government, from a union? Are you worried that this is going to be seen as somehow negative and that you're going to have haters and those haters might be everybody's bosses? Like, has that come across your mind yet?
I mean, I'm very fortunate. The school that I work at, I have an incredibly supportive administration and generally teaching staff too. So that's my own experience. I do know, again, having spoken to a number of educators, there have been incidents, but I also feel I do have this sense that there might be kind of an anticipatory anxiety about this from teachers, that there might be a hesitancy to actually engage in it. And, you know, when we actually start doing this, we might be surprised by how supportive people are. You know, due to like work that you're both doing with this podcast, doing, you know, something seems to be emerging in culture about being able to speak openly. And again, whatever way you do that, but there's something emerging that is starting to break things open a bit more. And so my hope would be with the conference is that there's going to be kind of a sense of, oh, this can be done. Whether you take tiny little steps, whether you take big steps, whether it's in your classes or maybe it's within co-curriculars or extracurriculars, it is possible to do. And we can normalize at least opening up a conversation about, you know, what we're eating, the health ramifications of that, the effects on animal sentience, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah.
I also think that the student has changed over the years.
Yeah.
And the interest and the perspective and the thought process might be more advanced than it used to be. And they seem to speak up a lot more in what they believe in. I know that they do now more than when I was growing up and saw those milk posters on the wall in my schools. But there are students that are willing to voice their opinions and make change in their schools. And hopefully those students will be able to cause an effect, a positive one, on their staff members as well, and their schools and their student body. And that's a whole other perspective that can be looked at as well.
I could not agree more. That is so true. I think that's really, and I know you've spoken about this before, like that's where the change is. A big push is going to come from the students, because I'm seeing more and more students who are interested in plant-based lifestyle, looking at animal rights, animal sentience. I'm seeing that. And I think there's a lot of students who have maybe been intimidated before to even speak about that, but then they're seeing space in schools to actually be able to do that. You know, you see a lot of like animal protection clubs or animal justice clubs emerging. You see a lot more students who are requesting vegan food, for example. So I think that's very inspiring. And I think that's also going to help in terms of our colleagues and the administrations are going to see, oh, we actually have to honor this. And there's also from an equity and inclusion perspective too, it's important that to realize there's a number of students that are plant-based for ethical or religious reasons. And if we're engaging, if we're serving food that doesn't honor that, if we're going on field trips that don't honor that, if we are engaging in practices such as dissection that students aren't comfortable with, that is going against this emerging and very positive trend of being more and more aware about equity and inclusion of all backgrounds in our schools. So that has been an interesting thing. I've actually been working with students who have come forward and said, you know, things that I never realized myself, but I didn't see that they've actually pointed out to me. They said, you know, did you know this and this about our school? And then actually, you know, being able to explore that a bit more. So couldn't agree more on that point.
Let's talk about dissection for a moment, because I remember doing dissection in high school. I didn't have a problem with it then. I know I'd have a big problem with it now, but it seems as if it's a little bit old school at the same time, right? Like when we were doing dissection, there was no internet, there were no YouTube videos, there wasn't the technology to be able to actually take it apart and see what was inside. And now videos, like you can make it move and actually like see how blood is being pumped at the same time. It's almost like technology has outdone physical dissection. So there's so many other options. And I'm sure that in today's technology that they can actually recreate an eyeball or a frog or something like that to make it feel so real and be able to do it too. Because I think that for people who want to be doctors or surgeons, you know, there's definitely value in still dissecting, but does it have to be an actual animal? So what's happening in the school systems around that and what's possible?
Yeah, that's a great point, Shoshana. Like I think that's a really emerging area as well. And, you know, for example, there's a Society for Humane Science based in Vancouver with Dr. Elizabeth Ormandy. She's done a lot of amazing work around this and helping teachers use some of these other methods, non-animal alternatives to dissection. There's a lot of amazing digital stuff that, for example, with the digital stuff, you can do it at home, especially in an online environment. You can go back to it. You can try it over and over and over. You can rotate things. You can add layers of skin and fur and muscle and bone. You know, I've seen examples of the software that it just pales in comparison. A good friend of mine is a vet, and he said, you know, he's done thousands of dissections in his education training. He said they never really helped him become a better vet in the end. So he's somebody who's actually done all this. But there's also amazing, there's a lot of paper models now that are emerging. So you can actually build these models and add the layers, and that's that kind of more tactile experience. And then I know more recently, there's a company in the States that have created a very, very, very lifelike artificial frog that actually, you know, you can actually cut open. You know, there's debate about that. Does that kind of still encourage the exploitation of animals? But I mean, the end result is you're not killing animals doing that. So this whole area of non-animal research and dissection methods, I think, is one that's emerging and growing incredibly in Canada and the U.S.
And then you wouldn't have to smell the formaldehyde, which for me was the worst part. Like, that makes you feel sick.
I know so there's the ethical and there's the religious reasons around this, but there's also just the kind of social emotional, you know, learning preferences too. So, I mean, my wife used to be a science teacher and she dropped science biology as a student because of dissection, you know, and then she actually had to do this as a teacher. And this is before she was kind of aware of larger animal issues, but she hated doing it. But it was mainly for this kind of yuck factor, you know, because it is quite disgusting. And then there's, you know, there's environmental ramifications of that. What do you do with the animals after and all the chemicals that are involved? But that's a lot of students actually talk about that too. They just find it disgusting.
So what else do you want us to know about the conference? What can you tell us about what people can expect or how do they get tickets? And can we be inviting elementary school students, high school students? Give us the spiel.
Yeah, so the spiel you can find out at www.educatorsforanimalsconference.ca. That is the main website. And we have an amazing lineup. So our first keynote speaker is Luis Cihoyos, who is the Academy Award winning filmmaker. He did The Cove. He also did Racing Extinction and The Game Changers. But then we also have about 45 educators who are going to be running sessions. And again, that's ranging from Valerie True, who's done some amazing work at the University of Guelph about turning their daycare, a lab daycare system, to completely plant-based, all the way through, you know, kindergarten, elementary grades, looking at using storybooks and children's literature. I know, Shoshana, you're going to be presenting about kind of mindfulness and approaching working with school communities around that, and then all the way up into post-secondary. Yeah, so that's going to be quite amazing. And right now, we're going to be opening up the registration probably in the next few days, so keep your eye out for that. And in terms of inviting, we are going to have some students who are actually going to be speaking at the conference about their experience. So I haven't thought about the age level, though. That's interesting. I mean, we are going to be inviting pre-service teachers, but it would be great to have students on there as well. So maybe I'll have to look into that and get some more sessions going in that respect.
Well, I think it's going to be an amazing opportunity for everyone who shows up to this conference to really learn a little bit more and dive deeper into this whole education around animals and how it impacts our society, our lifestyle, and the way we teach our students about it. I think that makes a huge difference. And then bringing more awareness to something that perhaps people don't really pay enough attention to. So thank you for putting that together. I'm really excited to see how it pans out.
I think this is just the first initiative for this network. So this is really kind of our big opening. And we're hoping to have maybe 100, 200 educators come together August 18th and 19th virtually. But who knows after? I mean, that's going to lead to more and more things, and we can speak about that a bit too. But But I'm very excited. And it really just started with a few emails a few months ago. And it just being, oh, this is the obvious next step. This is the obvious next step. And the excitement generated around this conference has been amazing. It's really provided a lot of uplift for me.
Well, you've been doing an amazing job. My inbox is filled with your emails, and I think I owe you one. So, everything has been so organized, you know, everything from like a 15-minute getting to know you to, hey, what do you want to do? And all of these forms and all of that. So from being on that side of it, it's been amazing. I'm very critical, having run this podcast for so long and like liking things to be pretty smooth. I'm very critical of other people and how they're running things. And it's just been beautiful and amazing working with you. And I love the idea of this. And there's going to be people there who are completely vegan for the animals and let's do this and vegan world for everyone. And then there's going to be people who come who are just going to think about things in a different way too. And I think that's huge. And I think that's what's going to make a huge impact and ripple effect. Are Americans invited as well?
I would say anybody is invited. I really debated about, you know, whether I should open this up, kind of promote it. But there was this sense of, I don't know, there was just this sense of starting with Canada, and then, you know, we'll see where things go. Having said that, if I would invite any educator around the world to tune in, I think there's things that are kind of going to be universal about some of the messages and some of the best practices. So definitely, yeah, more the merrier.
Awesome. So then I'm going to encourage our listeners to share this podcast with at least the website educatorsforanimalsconference.ca with at least one teacher or educator that they know. Doesn't have to be a teacher, but an educator, somebody working in the schools that they know. And let's ramp the numbers up and let's help make a change throughout the world, because it's not going to just affect the whole world. It's going to affect our children as well, and the way that our children start to empathize more. So I think that that is super important. And we will put the link, educatorsforanimalsconference.ca, at our show notes at planttrainers.com. Is there anywhere else where people can take a look and see what you have going on?
Yeah, so you can, through that website, you can find our social links. So we have a Facebook page, and we also have a Twitter feed as well. So you can definitely follow us for those outlets as well.
At Educators for Animals Conference.
Yeah, that's perfect. Right.
Good. So we'll link there as well.
Yeah, we'll link to all of that. Mike, thank you so much for joining us on the show today, the Plant Trainers Podcast. The work you're doing is so super important, and you're going to impact so many students and teachers, and we're so happy to be a part of it. So thank you for being here.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, I'll throw it back at you. Thank you so much for all of the work. I feel like I'm standing on so many shoulders, just kind of diving into my own initiative with this. But I realize there's so many people like yourselves who've been working at this for so many years and creating so much incredible momentum and so many good cultural grooves that now we can take advantage of and step into. So thank you so much for this.
Thank you.
Thank you all so much for listening to this edition of the Plant Trainers Podcast. We want to make sure that you subscribe on iTunes, Google Play, iHeartRadio, Stitcher, or any other podcasting platform.
We really appreciate the feedback we receive from you. Every time we get a 5-star rating or review on iTunes from one of our fans, it really helps other people find us, just like you did.
Thanks so much to our patrons. To become a patron, visit us at patreon.com/planttrainers. Even supporting us with $1 really makes a difference in the quality of the show.
And don't forget to connect with us on Instagram and Twitter. Our handle is @PlantTrainers. Like Plant Trainers on Facebook, join our newsletter, and check out our website at planttrainers.com for awesome recipes, a list of our services, and of course, our latest podcast.
We encourage you to email your questions to info@planttrainers.com so that we can help you improve your quality of life through nutrition and fitness.
So we hope we've inspired you today. Join us again next time,
and have a healthy day.
Or is that too corny?
It's a little cheesy.